I had this fear when they gave me this, talk about fear, I had this fear when they gave me this time limit of 8 minutes that I can't even introduce myself in 8 minutes. So what I'm gonna do is give you my presentation in 1 minute, and then we'll go back and fill it in. So the things that you need to know from the presentation that I'm gonna give is that you need core values, and those core values are take control of your life, take control of your situation, because you're the only one that can take control, and if you allow others to take control, they will control it in ways that you don't like. Work hard. Be persistent, because every day is not going to be a charm. Be honest, not only honest with other people, but with yourself. And the other thing is you can't do this alone. So you need skills in order to build a team. So be respectful to other people. Don't make yourself the center of attention, as I'm up here making myself the center of attention. Communicate precisely, and more importantly, listen intently. Don't assume that you have all the answers, because you don't. Seek input. Remain flexible and agile, because life is about being flexible and agile. And remain loyal. Remain loyal to those that work for you and those that you work for. And let me sort of leave you in my minute on a sort of a downer. 2 years ago, and you know, when you get to a certain age, this sort of stuff startles you. 2 years ago, I was teaching a course at Norwich College, and I said, okay, how many of you know Bob Hope? These are seniors. Not one person raised their hand. And I started to think about that. Here was one of the most famous people in the world, and two generations later, no one knew him. So many of us, and here's the downer, many of us are not going to be known 2 generations from now, 3 generations in our family. Think of that. Our names will be forgotten. But the one thing that the legacy that you can bring to anybody that's out there is teach them how to succeed so they can teach others how to succeed. That's the legacy that we need to go, is to help other people to be successful. So as Andy Kaufman used to say, thank you very much. Now let me go back and fill some of those blanks in. First of all, thank you, Adam, for inviting me here. I really appreciate it. This is a very, very successful event. I've been inspired by Mary. I've been inspired by the music. I've been inspired by, you know, just every speaker. Colin, just a minute ago, it's just amazing. And, you know, what's amazing to me is that you got me up here talking. Because when I was between 14 and 18 years old, you would have thought I was the biggest loser in the world. And by the way, I was. you know, my life was sort of spinning out of control. You know, I was what you would call a hooligan, I guess, in high school. If there was trouble to be found, I found it. And by the way, if I couldn't find it, I went looking for it. And it wasn't my fault, I thought. You know, it was teachers' fault. They didn't understand me. The police were out to get me. You know, nobody really understood what was going on. And I blamed it on everybody else. You know, I blamed it on a family that was, you know, spiraling out of control because of alcoholism. I blamed it, you know, not on me. I took no blame. You know, it wasn't my fault. It was just the situation. And you know what? I also said, the way to get out of this is like some movie star that's in a restaurant and some producer comes along and picks them out by fate. That's what I thought. You know, hey, by luck, maybe I'll get out of this. That was my plan. That's not a good plan, by the way. But that was my plan, that somehow fate would pluck me out. You know, I always thought that lying was another way of persuasion, which is not also a good thing to think of. So, you know, at around 18 years old, when everybody was going to college, and when I looked out there and I looked at my life, there was 2 avenues I could have traveled. One, a very dangerous, dark avenue, which could have ended up in jail, or an avenue that was different. And I chose the different avenue. And people talk to me and say, what was the event that did it? And you know what? It was dumb luck. It finally hit me. I said, I've got to change my life. I've got to take responsibility for my life. I've got to be honest with myself in terms of, do I like where I'm going and what I'm doing? And the answer was no. And the only one that could change it would be, is me. Now, you, if you've ever read the, what was it? It was Stephen Covey's 7 Habits of Highly Successful People. He says his first thing is take control of your life. Well, I figure he owes me a lot of money because I discovered it 25 years before he wrote it. So that's what I think. But I said, you know, I've got to change this. This is heading nowhere. So 3 weeks after my 18th birthday, I enlisted in the Navy. I enlisted in the Navy, quite frankly, because there was a draft going on, and I thought, well, you know, on a boat, you're not going to get shot at, things like that. You know, that's it. And then I did a sort of a 180 here, and I said, oh, that looks pretty cool, being a Navy SEAL, because I saw a film. And still in that sort of mode yet, that you don't really understand that you have to work for things that you want. So I went to SEAL team, and there was a rude awakening at that point. But I learned something. I started out with the class, I think it was 156. We graduated 17. And I learned something. If you want something in life, you have to work for it. And I learned also that every day is not going to be a holiday. Every day is not going to be what you dreamed it would be. And some days there are going to be setbacks. But you, because obviously I wasn't the biggest. I wasn't the strongest. I wasn't the fastest. But boy, was I persistent. And every day I said, I'm going to get through this day. And I want to talk about that in a little while. So in a year's time, I had a complete change in values. One that talked about honesty, not only to myself, but to others. One that said taking control of your life was important. To work hard, because nothing is easy. And to be persistent. Those became my value systems. But if you've ever been and talked to Navy SEALs, the interesting thing is they will always describe themselves as in the teams. They will talk about he's in the teams or I'm in the teams. They won't say I'm a SEAL. They'll say I'm in the teams. Now, in those days, there was only 2 teams, so it was easy. Now there's like dozens, and you know, I always say it's not as elite as it used to be. But it is. But you know, the thing about this team aspect of it is really important because the team concept helps you get over just about any obstacle there is and helps with success. So what are those sort of things that you have to do to really be a good team member? Well, one is you got to be respectful. You got to respect the people that are in your team. You got to be respectful to them, and they got to be respectful to you. You know, one of the things that if you're in SEAL team training, look, it's pretty brutal. It's, you know, it's not fun at all. But one of the things that I remember was the people who used to whine about an exercise and the people that used to brag about an exercise. And I said, how dumb can you be? Because the instructors would pick you out as fast as you started whining or bragging, and you went to what was called a circus. Now, that sounds like a nice little thing to do, go to a circus, but here's what a circus is. Your first exercise is 1,500 jumping jacks. Your circus goes on for about 3 or 4 hours of calisthenics. You don't get the sleep that night because you're getting up early in the morning, so you don't get the sleep. That's what a circus is. So, you know, I learned not to draw attention to yourself. The team is most important. You got to communicate precisely and listen intently. And you don't assume you have all the answers. You seek input. And again, you remain flexible and agile, and you remain loyal. Those are the things that all of a sudden I had the skills that I thought were necessary to be a good team member. And being a team member, I thought was extremely important. Now, sometimes we have fears. If anybody ever tells you that they went through SEAL team training and didn't think about quitting, either they're lying or they didn't go through training. Because every day you think about quitting. Every day there's an obstacle that you don't think you can get over. And how I did it is just like everybody else did it. You took 1 minute at a time, or 5 minutes at a time, or 10 minutes at a time, or a day at a time. You didn't look ahead when you had major obstacles. You looked at how to get over the obstacle that was right before you at this time. Because looking ahead meant that you got yourself down about the things that are happening. So you address those things. And that's how it sort of helps in life when you feel overwhelmed with things. You take it at a time. You take it slow. You slow down. You take 1 minute at a time, or 10 minutes at a time, or an hour at a time, or a day at a time. I got to SEAL Team 2, and I was assigned to the 4th Platoon. 4th Platoon was the most badass veteran platoon that you could ever be assigned to. And I, badass in a good way, by the way. And here I was with my little National Defense ribbon. Everybody else had Bronze Stars, Silver Stars, Purple Hearts, all combat veterans. And it was led by a guy named Iron Mike Cadden. And I'm saying, oh my God. Short guy, 140 pounds, all these guys are 6'2", you know, massive reputations behind him. And I get a call, and Iron Mike says he wants to talk to me. So I'm the new guy. I figure, Iron Mike, you know, you're a little intimidated by a guy named Iron Mike. So he calls me in, and I figure he's just going to introduce me. I'm the new guy to the platoon. He's going to introduce me. And he says, I've got three rules. Excuse my language. I'm using his. He said, don't fuck up. Number two, if you fuck up, tell me. And number three, I'm not your mother. If you have a personal problem, call your mother. I leave and I go, okay, this is not what. But, you know, I thought about it, and there were several things he was trying to drive home. He meant when don't F up, excuse me. He said, he was trying to say, I'm giving you a lot of responsibility. Take this responsibility and do something with it. The number thing, if you screw up, tell me. How many times have you made a mistake and you said, I can fix it because I made the mistake. And you try to fix it, and what happens is it gets worse and worse and worse. The better way is to tell somebody that you've done it, and maybe they can help you out with it. And it's hard to do to go to somebody and say, I've screwed up. And what he was also saying when I'm not your mother is, don't bring your personal problems to work. This was especially, you know, meaningful in SEAL Team. Don't bring your personal problems to work. How much time I got? Two more stories and then, okay. I deployed with SEAL Team 2, Platoon 4, a squad. My first assignment was Bolivia. I'm in the jungles of Bolivia, and I just plow through all the things he told me not to do. We had Brazilian explosives come in, and I was trying to clear this huge log jam in this huge river. And these logs were telephone pole-sized logs, huge log jam. So we get Brazilian explosives, and I can't read the Portuguese instructions. So I just figure, you know, America is the number one power in the world. The explosives must be, you know, half as potent as American explosives. So I load this explosives onto this, and it took me all day. I mean, this was massive. Load all these explosives, you know, under this, and I'm diving under and doing all this stuff, loading this thing to get this logjam out of the river. And I touch off that shot, And I start looking and looking and looking as about 200 logs or 300 feet in the air. And I'm saying, what goes up must come down. And thank God I didn't kill anybody. But I took out a piece of the jungle that looked like a Walmart parking lot after I was done. So I screwed up all the time in terms of what's going on. So let me just close by a couple of things. One is that, we all have to have core values that are meaningful, that are core to us, that are important to us. We all need to devise a team and devise that circle of trust. And that circle of trust means that what you do is give people innovative, give them the ability to innovate, give them the ability to make mistakes. And when they make mistakes, you back them up, because that's how you move forward. And most of all, make sure that you in life passes on the ability of others to succeed, because that is your legacy. Thank you very much.